Today is not just the beginning of a war between the Japanese Empire and the United States of America. Today is the beginning of a war all over the South Pacific and Southeast Asia. The Japanese carriers are now just 190 miles from Oahu. They were not supposed to go closer than 200 miles, but to a damaged plane or one short on gas, a few miles extra might be too much to survive. Admiral Ryunosuke Kusaka is chief of staff of Kido Butai, and coming closer is his idea. He is on the deck of Akagi and has been watching faint black dots appear in the sky and grow larger for nearly 10 minutes. The planes begin arriving in ones and twos. 324 planes that flew today make it home safely, all told. 29 planes with 55 men are lost. Planes are soon rearmed and refueled for a third wave of attack, but this attack will not take place. Admiral Nagumo decides against it. When Fuchida arrives at 1 p.m., the last plane to do so, a heated discussion about another attack wave is still in progress. Nagumo says they have achieved the desired results. The statement had a touch of finality that showed the way the admiral's mind was working. He had always been against the operation, but had been overruled. So he had given it his very best and accomplished everything they asked of him. He had gotten away with it, but he certainly wasn't going to stretch his luck. Fuchida argues that there is no defense left on the island, but Kusaka ends the discussion and the attack is terminated. Aboard the Nagato and following the events of the day, Yamamoto says a few minutes before this that he knows Nagumo is going to withdraw. He is correct. Nagumo and Kusaka decide that even if a third wave is 80% successful, the other 20% is not worth the risk. At 1:30, the fleet changes course and heads for home. There will be no more attacks on Oahu this day. But there will be, and have already been, a great many Japanese attacks this day elsewhere. The Malayan campaign begins today. Well, it began this morning, even before the attack on Pearl Harbor did. This was not intended, but Jisaburo Uzawa's battle fleet began bombing Kota Baru in northern Malaya at 1:15 a.m. local time, December 8th. Malaya is composed partly of British protectorates and is partly under direct rule of the Crown. And much like the attacks on the United States, this attack is a violation of international law because the Japanese do not declare war on the British either. Before this bombardment, at 11 p.m. local time the 7th, the Japanese give Thailand an ultimatum to allow Japanese forces to enter Thailand. The Thai government has 2 hours to respond. They debate a response, but Playek Pibulsongkram, prime minister and dictator, is nowhere to be found, and he doesn't even hear of the ultimatum until later in the morning. At dawn, though, Japanese troops cross from Indochina into Thailand's Phra Thabong province. A main Japanese objective down south is the port city of Songkla, and before dawn, three regiments from Lieutenant General Yamashita's 25th Army make landings there supported by four destroyers. The Thai garrison blocks the road leading down to Malaya, but they are quickly brushed aside by the invaders. Patani is another main objective because it is so close to the Malayan border, but the attacks here meet stiff resistance and are unable to proceed until an armistice is signed at noon. This not only ends all British hopes of an alliance with Thailand, but gives Japan permission to use Thailand as a base to better invade Malaya. That actual operation is units of the 25th Army with naval cover from Vice Admiral Kondo's Southern Force. Singapore is the ultimate goal. Yamashita commands 4 divisions total, but thinks 3, under 60,000 men total, will suffice to beat the limited fighting capacity of the local British and colonial forces. They begin with an amphibious assault on Kota Baru after the bombardment. At 4 a.m., 17 Japanese bombers raid Singapore, the first time it has ever been bombed, and a warning to the British that Japanese bombers from Indochina are very much within range of all of Malaya. 61 people are killed. Initial resistance comes from the Indian Army's 3rd Corps and a few British battalions. The Japanese have a bit of the edge in troop numbers, but an enormous one in air support, tactics, experience, and armor. In fact, the Allies have no armor here. Also, Japanese light tanks and bicycle infantry allow them swift movement along the rainforest paths and trails. Off of Kotobaru today, an Australian Air Force Hudson bombs a Japanese troop transport. It catches fire and is abandoned. Japan also attacks the Philippines today using Formosa as the attack base. The main attacks destroy much of America's Far East Air Force at the Luzon airfields. Now, I will cover this in detail in the December 12th regular weekly episode because it happens later on today, but it is of major importance. The Battle of Hong Kong begins this morning. Now, Hong Kong is a British Crown colony, and the defense garrison there is made up of British, Canadian, and Indian units, the Auxiliary Defense Units, and the Hong Kong Volunteer Defense Corps. These defenders total 14,564, including the nurses. The attack here begins 4 hours after that on Pearl Harbor, so in a bit under an hour and a half from now. And the defenders are outnumbered 4-1. The colony also has no real air defense, and two of the Royal Navy's three destroyers here are ordered to make for Singapore. The airport is bombed, and the first real exchange of fire on the ground comes in the afternoon between the 14th Punjabi Regiment and the invaders at Lafan's Plain. In the evening, forward Punjabi troops will pretty much wipe out a Japanese unit on the Taipo Road. Hawaii and the Philippines are not the only American possessions attacked today. Far from it. Guam is one of them. Now, the American government doesn't think it's really practical or even possible to defend Guam from a big attack. And in fact, it has a Category F defense rating, meaning that they aren't building any new defenses, and if war does break out, the defenders are to destroy anything of military value and make tracks. But this is not really what happens. The Marines there, under Lieutenant Colonel William McNulty, have fortified their posts, and the local militia that protects the naval base has been expanded. The garrison commander, who's in charge of the naval forces, Captain George McMillan, is also Guam's governor. There are only a few hundred defenders total. McMillan gets word about Pearl Harbor just before 5 a.m. And at 8:27, the Japanese launch air attacks all over Guam. The largest military ship there, the minesweeper Penguin, shoots down a Japanese plane, but is itself sunk. Wake Island is also hit today by 36 Japanese medium bombers flown from the Marshall Islands. Midway Island is bombarded today by two Japanese destroyers. They damage the marine base there, killing four, but they're driven off by the coastal batteries. There is an incident involving the US and Japan today that is not an attack as well. On the westernmost Hawaiian island, Niihau, a Zero crash lands there. The Japanese Navy designated it as an island for crash landing pilots to await rescue. A Hawaiian local takes the pilot's guns and his papers, though he is unaware of the Pearl Harbor attack. More locals welcome the pilot with Hawaiian hospitality, though they too do not understand Japanese. Finally, a local who does is brought in. The pilot tells him about the events of the day, and he agrees to help the pilot get his papers and escape. Niihau does not have telephones, but that night, a radio report alerts the islanders to what has happened at Pearl. The pilot is unable to even buy back his papers, and after some pretty hair-raising scenes and an escape attempt, he is killed. Now, you should look up the Niihau incident for yourselves. It is a pretty good tale of adventure. But back to all the battles. Just what kind of armies, navies, and air forces have I been talking about today? Let's go back and look at it a bit. Japan had, as I said, withdrawn from the London Naval Disarmament Conference and begun a major naval construction program. Thing is, the various powers that be in the Navy don't agree on how the future fleet is going to look. Career officers who had fought in battles in the Russo-Japanese War think battleships are still the key. But knowing that they don't have the resources of Britain or the US for numerical equality, these guys want to build super battleships with 21-inch guns, superior to anyone else in a one-on-one situation. Newer progressive guys like Yamamoto think naval air forces are the future. They sure don't believe in super battleships, thinking that nothing is completely unsinkable. And anyhow, these could be neutralized from the air before they could even fire on each other. Okay, these guys are outvoted by the naval planners, though. And in 1936, three Yamato-class super battleships are planned. This makes sense from a traditional perspective, though, because Japan's strategic, not tactical, Strategic planning is defensive, like the enemy would enter into the Japanese defense zone and then be destroyed in pitched battle. Naval planes and submarines will have softened up any advancing fleet with a series of attacks on it outside of this zone. A possible problem with this is that it focuses only on combat and not transportation. And by that, I mean as something to be defended or something to try and destroy. Many possible enemies, like the US, would have long and delicate supply lines that might be wrecked, but because of available resources, the focus on battleship construction means that other branches of the Navy don't really get beefed up that much, like naval aircraft and lighter ships like destroyers and escorts. But by December 1941, Japan still has one mother of a navy, 10 battleships, 6 heavy and 4 light aircraft carriers, and around 630 operational planes. They have 6 seaplane carriers and 70 seaplanes, mostly for recon, and 18 coastal command centers with around 1,400 planes. The pilots for all of this fly to an excellent standard, since a lot of them have flown in the war in China. 65 subs are fast enough when surfaced to follow a modern navy. The larger ones even have seaplanes. Japan does not have a lot of cruisers, 38, but what they do have are armed to the teeth. And they have 113 destroyers, the most modern ones carrying 24-inch torpedoes, which can go 16 miles at 40 knots and carry an explosive charge of over 1,100 pounds. Japan is, however, way behind in radar and radio development. Now, the Imperial Japanese Navy has not had that much to do recently compared to the Army, which has borne the brunt of the war in China. This quickly became a war of attrition, and so despite the Japanese Army growing from 400,000 to over 2 million men during these years, with 1.5 million in China and Manchuria, standards of training have gone way, way down, especially in the occupied areas, with new and replacement officers entrusted with appointments well beyond their experience and capability. On the other hand, Japanese infantry is incredibly combat efficient. With courage and endurance, few other soldiers in the world can match. And a big chunk of them would literally fight to the last man rather than suffer the dishonor of being taken prisoner. They have 51 operational divisions, with just 5 of those stationed in Japan, 10 depot divisions to train replacements and recruits for deployment overseas, 21 independent brigades, and 37 brigade-level units of AA, artillery, engineers, all that sort of stuff. There is an Army Air Corps of around 1,500 planes in 5 divisions. They are not at all as mechanized as the Western armies. And they learned in 1939 at Khalkhin Gol that their armor is no match for that of the Soviets. Artillery and transport are mostly made up of horse-drawn units. The Japanese are exceptionally good at creating meticulously detailed operations and operational planning, but they are far less so at logistics and intelligence. The Japanese armed forces' most serious shortcoming was the wholly inadequate degree of cooperation between its constituent services, which led an isolated existence and seldom made any attempt to dismantle the barriers between them. The Navy and Army regarded each other with deep suspicion and would only consent to shelve their differences if subjected to outside pressure. If you then take a look at the whole US Army and Navy in 1941, and at the Marine Corps and Army Air Forces, which have a decent amount of independence, the naval battle fleet is 15 older and 2 new battleships. They have 7 aircraft carriers that can send up 650 planes. When the US gets alarmed by German conquests in 1940, they spend a ton on beefing up the military, though, especially if they're going to have a two-ocean navy in future. So to outclass anyone in any navy, in early December 1941, they are either in the building or preliminary building stages of 15 battleships, 11 carriers, 54 cruisers, 191 destroyers, and 73 subs. This is, though, a multi-year program. Like the Japanese, the American thinking in the high command is mainly traditional. The focus is on the battleship and the big decisive battle. There are some 65,000 Marines, 25,000 of them in a fleet Marine force, which is 2 divisions with their own air force, landing craft, and amphibious vehicles. The Army suffers the most of the military service branches post-1918 from budget cuts. In 1932, At its lowest number, there are 132,000 men. By 1940, it has 270,000 men in 9 infantry, 2 cavalry, and 1 armored division. But the majority of those are only brigade strength. Conscription is introduced, and the army suddenly grows to 1.5 million men. Arms and equipment undergo modernization from the end of the 30s. So the army is really going through a real metamorphosis around now. And in December 1941, there are only a few combat-ready units. These are deployed in the Philippines. The Army Air Forces are considered essential for strategic aerial warfare. The thinking seems to be like that of Italian air power theorist Giulio Dewes. Priority was given to the construction of heavy long-range bombers and the development of fast long-range fighters and fighter bombers for use in close support for troops on the ground was initially neglected. The strategic function of long-range bombers enjoyed great favor in political circles too and engendered the delusion that the stationing of B-17 bombers in the Philippines would suffice to deter a Japanese attack. As for the British in Southeast Asia, they have done barely any reinforcing at all because the war in Europe takes all their resources. Hong Kong is regarded as indefensible because of the Japanese army strength in China. They have the naval fortress of Singapore and some air bases on the Malay Peninsula. They only have like 140 planes in Malaya though, and these are inferior to the Japanese and 33 battalions of boots on the ground. Singapore has pretty strong coastal defenses, but not much on the landward approach, since the British believe the jungle to be a natural defense shield. The Dutch, of course, are cut off from their home by the German occupation. They have some old cruisers and destroyers, 160 or so planes, and some 38,000 troops, which can absolutely not defend their thousands of island possessions from the Japanese. As of December 2, 1941, Britain has battleships Prince of Wales and Repulse at Singapore, but that's certainly not going to impress the Japanese. As for the US Navy, they have to face a two-ocean war, which has been one reason to not enter war prematurely and one for Japan to get moving as soon as possible. War in the Pacific is going to be very different from the war in Europe or North Africa. Space and time factors and the size and structure of armed forces were governed by the geographical conditions prevailing in an ocean larger than the Earth's entire landmass. It's true, the Chilean coast to Indochina is half the way around the entire world. The Australasian coastline is really just thousands of islands, archipelagos, and mini-seas. The islands are volcanic with coral reefs that help create natural harbors that give many small islands military and economic might. The Hawaiian Islands, for example, are a major hub. They're 2,000 miles west of San Fran, but from Hawaii west to Manila in the still American Philippines is about 5,000 miles. And that runs through Guam, Wake Island, and Little Midway. And that little network is of major importance to the US since the Philippines are a great base from which to safeguard American interests in the whole region. The waters of Southeast Asia and beyond are hit by typhoons in the summer and fall that can be disastrous to shipping and coastal regions in general. The islands are hot and the islands are humid. There are not very many roads. The vegetation is often dense and there are lots of ups and downs. Physical ones. Like in the Philippines and the Solomon Islands, there is jungle up to 3,000 feet altitude, and the mountains in Papua New Guinea are as high as 15,000 feet. So you simply cannot send in large land forces without an extraordinary amount of logistical effort, and that is still a huge everyday strain on every soldier. Any kind of success by anyone would necessarily involve combined air, sea, and land operations, period. Navies and air forces have to be capable of serious long-distance travel, and navies will need mobile supply facilities and mobile maintenance ones just to cover the huge distances. Many of the endless islands are great supply and deployment points. In the air, recon is of prime importance when your enemy may be anywhere over thousands of miles. Naval aircraft flying from both land and aircraft carrier are perfect for this. Flying boats with multiple engines can cover over 2,000 miles nonstop, and they're super reliable. And by now, long-range bombers are available not only for strategic bombing, but even support for operations both on land or at sea. Surprise is vital because you simply can't have large-scale blitzkrieg thrusts on land with mechanized units because of the lack of roads. You don't have long front lines. To win, you have to hit the coast, hit it hard, hit it by surprise, and hit it with infantry backed by local artillery superiority. And then hold the territory taken with secure supply lines and major naval and aerial support. Hygiene and medicine will play much larger roles here than in other arenas because of the preponderance of disease and infection in the region. Now, you may wonder why the US is so interested in Southeast Asia to the point of being against an Asiatic economic bloc led by the Japanese anyhow. It's because they want to keep open the huge Chinese market, but also because of the amount of raw materials they need from the region. The US gets 90% of its tin and rubber from British Malaya and the Dutch East Indies. So a Japanese annexation would be a major issue. Since the American public is still largely isolationist in 1940 and at least much of 1941, sending the Navy to Singapore as security is not politically feasible. The options other than force are economic thumbscrews, tightened and loosened as needed, and more aid to China to tie down Japan militarily and economically there. Thus, China is included in Lend-Lease. The naval buildup program also, of course, provokes a sense of urgency in many Japanese. The Lend-Lease program, by the way, which is actually formally called an Act to Promote the Defense of the United States, is enacted March 11th. Under its terms, the US can supply Britain, France, and China, and then the Soviet Union after Germany invades, and eventually other allied nations with warships, planes, weapons, oil, food, ammunition, all as a loan until after the war, since you don't sell water to your neighbor when his house is on fire, or in exchange for the lease of military bases on other nations' territory. But back to that Japanese sense of urgency, which has led to today. I mentioned what happened after Fuchida landed, but this is what he's doing now. He decides to make one final round and fly to Kahuku Point to gather any fighters that are still flying there, and then return to the carriers.
The general commander's plane ran at the point and found, as suspected, another stray fighter. I successfully returned to the mothership leading these two fighters. However, the senior petty officer of maintenance told me, Commander, you had no fuel left. It was a big risk that you did not return earlier. Besides, it was dangerous because the control wire was almost completely severed. I responded, We are at war. I will fly even if the control wire is cut. The maintenance crews listening to the conversation must have thought that the general commander was insane. They were right. I was, in fact, a crazy officer with a burning desire to serve my country.
FDR hoped, up until the very last moment, to avoid open war. You can see that in his general response to code-breaking successes. Now, the Americans shared with the British their success at cracking the Japanese diplomatic code already in 1940 and gave them a machine for reading it in January 1941. The Japanese Navy, again, does not use that code, though. They use JN-25, an enciphered code with five numeral groups for transmission. John Tittman, with the help of Alan Turing, the noted British mathematician and cryptanalyst, has, by 1941, figured out that it is a five-digit code with a code book to translate words into five-digit and a second book the sender uses to add to those original numbers. It was just changed a few days ago, but by then, it was likely only around 10% readable. The Japanese Navy has not been engaged in major battle operations recently, so the analysts, they don't have much to work with. During 1941, The knowledge gained about German naval disposition from Britain's Enigma intercepts, Enigma being the German code, is regularly used by the US to avoid incidents when it could easily be used to provoke them. Even the order to shoot at German subs on sight is more to scare them than it is to provoke them. And knowing that U-boats have orders to avoid incidents with the US, FDR can push forward with aid for Britain, knowing there will be, at worst, only isolated incidents. The agreement with the Danes for American bases on Greenland and a joint defense of it in April 1941 causes alarm in Berlin, but that's about it. And why should such things cause war anyhow? Countries are not simply either at war or not at war. In American history, there was a quasi-state of war with France at the turn of the 19th century. Just over the past few years, Japan and the USSR have had several bloody encounters, but they've still maintained diplomatic relations. Roosevelt even says, October 8, 1940, "The time may be coming when the Germans and the Japs will do some fool thing that will put us in. That's the only danger of our getting in." The US does have war contingency plans, both solo and together with the British, Canadians, and eventually the Australians and the Dutch. The British and Americans have worked out the strategies they will pursue if Germany, and later Japan, brings the Americans into the war. The priority is always dealing with Germany first, with major offensives against Japan only if they go to war too and Germany has been defeated. Roosevelt hears warnings about Pearl Harbor, but the overall situation just does not make sense to American politicians that Japan would attack them. Well, not at Pearl. Tokyo has been pushing forward in East Asia while promising restraint to the US and Britain. That basic decision was made back in 1940 already. In August that year, negotiations to take over the Dutch East Indies began. Seriously. But while the Japanese were able to buy a lot of oil, they got exactly nowhere with the plan of a treaty binding the Indies with Japan, which you can kind of understand once Japan allied itself with Germany in September that year, since Germany had just, you know, invaded and conquered the Netherlands. So then, Japan really tried to secure the Indies oil with a huge increase in deliveries under long-term contracts. They wanted the annual amount increased to 3.15 million tons, and of that, 400,000 tons of high-octane aircraft fuel. The colonial Dutch government is pretty cozy with American oil companies, though, and they strung out talks until October before finally offering a total of 1.36 million tons and just 33,000 tons of aviation fuel. See, the Western powers are the Dutch main customers in general, so the Dutch are pretty uncooperative with the Japanese and only issued short-term contracts. Japan had to either accept, which they did, or use military force. And the consequence of that is obvious. As for Japan's thoughts to the north, not knowing that Germany plans on attacking the Soviets in 1941, Japan actively tries to improve relations with them, like getting the Soviet Union to join the Axis, which Germany puts the kibosh on, and the eventual neutrality treaty with the USSR in April 1941. This is so Japan's rear will be safe if and when they head south against the British, Dutch, and Americans. Germany's actually down with this for the encouragement it gives Japan to make that move. Germany tries to get Japan to attack Singapore again and again, thinking of the damage it would do to Britain. They even give Japan the captured intel from November 1940 that Britain would not, well, could not even if they wanted to, send major naval units to the region in case of Japanese attack. Germany also says if Japan feels that they can only hit Singapore by hitting the US at the same time, then they can count on Germany to join them in war. Adolf Hitler promises this to then-Japanese Foreign Minister Yosuke Matsuoka, April 4th, 1941. So all the 1941 US-Japanese talks alarm the Germans. The last thing Germany wants is an American fleet not tied down in the Pacific in either open war or by heavy tension. They also do not realize that this negotiating is over an unofficial proposal that neither side had actually proposed, as you will soon see. So, to sum up, Japan has gone to war. to rapidly secure the resources of Southeast Asia. Attacking the U.S. at Pearl Harbor is to cover their flank from any American interference. In a similar way, a neutrality treaty was signed with the USSR to protect their rear in Manchuria from Soviet interference. Japan also thinks it is just not safe to bypass the American-defended Philippines. The main objectives of this huge operation are to quickly take Malaya and the Philippines in preparation for using them to then take the Dutch East Indies. To take Malaya, they need the Thai ports and airfields, so add Thailand to the initial attacks. If Japan can also occupy Burma, the Bismarck Archipelago, the Marshall Islands, the Gilbert Islands, and parts of New Guinea, then they will control the rubber, oil, and tin they need, and also have a full perimeter from which they can defend that empire against any and all aggressors. Simple. And now, it has begun.